Good evening, everybody.
Hi, good evening.
Is this good? Sound check?
Good.
Okay. Welcome to our second in the series of lecture series we're hosting as part of the general plan and the Mission Street, which is now blossomed into the downtown plan, specific plan update. And the purpose of the lecture series is primarily to invite national level speakers like our speaker this evening to share some insights on topics that are of interest to the community. So we had a few weeks back Paul Moore talk about mobility and accessibility. Tonight we'll have a talk on parking issues and parking management. And then next month, on April 18th, we are inviting Dr. Richard Jackson, and he'll be talking about the connection between public health and our built environment. Built environment, our cities, the connection between what we have built, and is it making us healthier, or is it making us sicker? So Jim Castle, an American artist, said, any place worth its salt has a parking problem. So the fact that you have a parking problem, that, and by the way, every city that we've worked in for the past 20 years has had a parking problem. So it's almost like a narcotic that ought to be a controlled substance. It's addictive, and one can't get enough of it. But we are a built-out city, and when we are built out, can you not hear me? Is that, you're asking me to hold up?
Who are you?
Oh, I'm so sorry. My name is Kaiser Rangwala. I have met many of you through the focus group meetings we've held. I am the lead consultant assisting the city in facilitating the updates to the general plan and the specific plan. I assume that there were many familiar faces, but may not have had a chance to meet all of you. So we are a built-out city, and we have limited resources in terms of how much land we can dedicate, how much resources we can dedicate towards the supply of parking. But there is a fine balance between supply and demand, and certainly using what we have more effectively. So managing what we have more effectively. And we have tonight's speaker, Dr. Richard Willson, who I just learned has spent 30 years, he just received his 30 years pin, as a professor at Cal Poly. He is the chair of the Urban Planning Program at Cal Poly. He has written a couple of books on parking. He's going to share them, share those books with you, the titles of the books. He has extensively lectured on the topic of parking policy and parking management. He is a graduate of UCLA Planning Program, where he received his Ph.D. and master's at USC. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Richard Willson.
Thanks, Kaiser. Well, hi, everybody. Appreciate you spending your Wednesday night talking about parking. Yes? Oh, you're saying hi back? I teach at Cal Poly Pomona, but I live in Mount Washington, just down the 110 or up the 110, depending on how you look at it. And I had the pleasure of giving a talk about parking at your library a couple years ago. And just to reinforce the point about frustrations with parking, that week I gave a presentation here in South Pasadena, and I gave a presentation in Silver Lake. And both places told me they had the worst parking problem on Earth, and they both can't have the worst at the same time, so maybe we'll have a competition. But I'm pleased to be here, and I think it's very exciting. You're working on your general plan and your specific plan. Times are changing, land uses are changing, transportation systems are changing, and so it's a great time to renew your plans. So I want to start by thinking of the future. So let's fast forward into the future. I've been in the transportation planning field a long time, and there has never been a time when the pace of change is what it is today. We have multiple trends, technology, demographics, the economy, that suggest that transportation 10 years from now, I mean, I'm not sure I can safely make predictions. It's that profound. So in the past, post-World War II, we really favored the automobile in our planning and transportation systems. And in the last few decades, we've been working on a more balanced system in Los Angeles with, you have a wonderful Gold Line station and thinking about getting people walking and biking and sharing rides. So we're in this new mode. But going forward, trends in car sharing and shared mobility services, things like Uber and Lyft, are going to affect how many cars people own. Now, out in the suburbs, that might take a long time to change, but in urban areas, my expectation is that people will own fewer cars. They may still use vehicles to get around, but that means we may not need as much parking at residences. And then, of course, if you're not driving that car somewhere but being dropped off, you may need less parking everywhere. And I'm not an urban designer, but that's a very exciting thing for urban designers to hear, because it means perhaps some of the land, Kaiser mentioned that South Pass is built out, but you have a lot of surface parking lots that could possibly be repurposed to something more useful, commercial or residential and that kind of thing. So it's a very exciting time. There's demographic changes as well, meaning some of the millennial generation are preferring car-free lifestyles, not all, but some, and that's a significant trend. And us baby boomers are going to need to figure out something to do when we need to stop driving. The other thing is cities are more actively managing everything about them. So instead of thinking of the library is a fixed resource, thinking of the library as a multi-use facility that can serve many community uses and change how it works throughout the decades. Similarly, parking is being managed more actively. And I'm going to get into that in a little bit. So here's some images kind of symbolizing this change. This is an Uber self-driving vehicle in Pittsburgh. This is an unused parking structure in Atlanta, where students at the Savannah School of Art and Design designed micro units. So they turned a parking structure into a residential facility. This, I don't know, this might not be right for South Pass. No? We had a Brazil guess. Anyone else want to guess? Correct, it's Miami. Yeah, this is the fanciest parking structure I've ever seen. And it was very expensive to build. It's, but the point of showing this image is not that this is the best design, but that it's a multi-purpose facility. The top windows is the guy lives. He lives there. In the middle is retail. The high clear stories, they have symphony concerts and weddings on it. The notion is, instead of thinking of especially parking facilities as used for one thing and one thing only, this is an adaptable facility that could be used for many different purposes as needs change.
So the cars are on the top?
The cars are on all levels, but when they have an event, they just say you can't park on the top level. And finally, before I was a professor, I worked at the Los Angeles Redevelopment Agency about a block down from there. That's the Bradbury building, I think you can see. And this is in front of Grand Central Market. And the city of LA wants to build a streetcar down Broadway. And so they thought to try out reusing the space, they took what was curb parking in front of the Grand Central Market and sort of with a very inexpensive temporary treatment, turned it into a place people could sit and eat. Now, if you'd have told me in 1984 that someday a curb parking space on Broadway in downtown LA would get turned into a pedestrian or people place, I wouldn't have believed you. But the fact of the matter is, here it is. And this kind of experimental urbanism is really catching on. Trying the idea of a parklet, temporarily turning a parking space into a park space. Trying things and seeing how they work. Very exciting for urban planners. So I think we're in a period of change, so we shouldn't let the past rule our thinking about parking. But let's come back to the present. I studied at UCLA with Donald Shoup, who's written a book called The High Cost of Free Parking that's got a lot of attention. And my two books that followed from his, he sort of says everything's wrong, and I worked as a municipal planner, so my thing is let's see how we can make some change. So I consider myself the parking whisperer. But here's the critique. Current parking practices are at odds with many community goals for sustainability. And especially in suburban areas, the parking required of developers is more than is actually used. So it's a waste of land and resources. In urban areas, parking requirements can be an impediment to economic development. And I'll give you an example of that in a minute. And finally, we have a housing crisis in this region. We're not producing enough housing units. So high parking requirements drive up the cost of housing and may reduce the amount of housing we can produce. So there's some serious issues with the status quo. I don't know if you can read that. It's kind of small, but you know, being a guy that studies parking, that's a pretty nerdy issue. Fortunately, I was married already before I chose this field, and I have a tolerant wife. But I think it's sexy because it's right at the center of things that urban planners and communities care about. You heard about transportation sustainability with your previous speaker. Parking influences how people travel. Parking influences design and urban form. Before I came in here, I just briefly walked on Mission and then Fair Oaks and noted the difference between Mission and Fair Oaks, which has to do with the era in which the buildings were built. And when parking sits in front of a building, it creates a rather less exciting street frontage than you have here on Mission. Parking is expensive, so it's an issue in development cost and economic development. And parking is an issue in sustainability. If we build parking for people who drive, we encourage driving. But also the parking lot itself is an urban heat island. It increases runoff. So it's not a very good use of land in cities. So the way I would say this rather complex diagram is often parking is the tail that wags the dog. So if there's a problem with parking in a community, and in my university, same thing. We had a new president came in. She met with the students. She said, "What's up at Cal Poly Pomona?" And they said, "Parking's terrible." And so you go from parking's terrible to build more parking. And so what I'm in favor of is in between that step, making sure you're managing parking, and maybe you don't have to build more parking by managing it efficiently. So parking requirements are way down at the end of that, way down the end of that chart. What we really want is connectivity between land uses, right? We want to get from home to work and from work to shopping. And if there's another way to do that through land use planning, telecommunication, substitution of travel, we should consider that. So parking shouldn't be what we start with. Parking is what we should perhaps end up with after we've considered other ways of connecting people between places. So this is my favorite place to pick on. Anybody recognize it? It's east of Cal Poly Pomona on the 10 at the 15. It's the Ontario Mills Shopping Center. So this is the classic critique of parking, where the mall is at the right. Each use is on its own site. So there's no mixed uses. There's a mall, there's an arena, there's office buildings, there's residential. Each one is separate. And each one has been required to build as much parking as it will ever need on the peak demand and then some. So that mall's parking is you know, full, I'm sure, the day after Thanksgiving and the peak holiday season, but most of the year it's half empty. So most of the year the sun is shining on it, it's radiating heat, it's doing nobody any good. To the left, the little white square is Citizens Bank Arena, a beautiful arena the City of Ontario built. If they'd have built it across the road from the mall, they could have shared parking, right? And across from it is an office building. So the arena has events mostly in the evening. The office building is mostly empty in the evening. So this is an example of the wastefulness of the design practices we've used in the suburbs, as well as the environmental impact of them. And if you ever try and go here and walk, it's a horrible place to try and cross the street. Yes, ma'am.
Constructions done all roughly, because I think Ontario Mills went in about 92, 93, so they weren't all done at the same time.
They weren't, but it was master planned. So that's the thing. This is what my field produced, and now my greatest challenge as an urban planner, places like South Pasadena have so many good things going, like you're just tinkering around. My question for planners is, how do you remake that into a walkable mixed-use community? That's a huge challenge that those communities will face. Okay, that's what it looks like on the ground. You know, the lines are straight, the palm trees are upright, and those spaces are rarely used. All right, do you recognize this place? It's your town. That's Mission, east-west, and Fair Oaks going north-south. So you don't have many of these problems. You have buildings up to the street. You have a very high-quality, walkable, pedestrian environment. You have small-scale uses. You have architectural variety. You have everything that every community wants right now. So you really are in a good position. Because I know a few people in South Pasadena, I'm aware of an example, though, where your old parking requirements of 10 spaces for every 1,000 square feet of restaurant were preventing restaurants from going into the Mission block because no one could find more parking in a historic building. And to the credit of the city, they revised their ordinance to deal with that. So the point here is that parking requirements can also be an invisible effect on economic development, and you might not even know about it. In other words, someone wanting to open a restaurant might learn about the parking requirement and just say, well, that's not going to work. I'm not even going to go to the counter at the city and see if I can do that. And obviously, very nice walkable environment on your local streets. So the first point, which is I'm getting to, is about zoning requirement reform. And so as you do your general plan, you'll set out policies for transportation and direction for parking. As you do your specific plan, you do have an opportunity to look at your parking requirements and make sure they're fitting your goals. So my first book was to help planners recommend changes to parking requirements. And this could, in some cases, mean eliminating them, which sounds like a travesty for what we're used to, but many cities are doing that. The city of Buffalo, New York, eliminated parking requirements citywide. Many cities have done this in their downtowns. What they're doing when they say it is, what they're saying when they do it is that we're going to use shared parking resources in an effort to encourage economic development. Now, I don't know what's right for South Pass or what's wrong. So I'm not proposing eliminating them or any specific number, but as your consultants and your staff planners work through this, this is the kind of steps you go through to justify a revision to the parking requirement or to suggest you're going to eliminate it. And it includes factors, oh, there's a handout, yes, please. It includes having some real data on parking use. Having clear understanding of how future trends are going to affect parking use. And then understanding things like what's happening with transit, biking, walking, shared parking, all those other things. And so only after you kind of go through all those steps can you really come up with a reasonable parking requirement. Unfortunately, in the past, what planners often did was call the neighboring city and say, what's your requirement, and kind of just copying, or looking up in a book that the engineers put out, which is national averages, which might not fit the local situation. So my book, Parking Reform Made Easy, is my attempt to help with this process. I'm bringing this up because the parking requirements are related to parking management, which I'm now about to get to. So, here's a parking space. It's actually the same one from Ontario Mills if you're counting the oil spots. So that could be a parking space that is never used or almost never used. It could be a parking space where I'm storing a car that I really intended to sell and I really don't need, but I just haven't got around to it, you know, just kind of storage. Or it could serve 15 short-term retail visitors, restaurant patrons at night, and someone that lives there overnight. My point here is it's the same space. It's the same geography, same real estate, and the first use is obviously inappropriate. It's not needed. The last one, that's a parking space that is really supporting activities in a district. So I think the way we should look at this is to increase how well we use our parking spaces. And what I mean by that is a parking space used during the day and not at night is not very efficiently used, and vice versa. I like to pick on the worst example is Angel Stadium in Anaheim. It has a lot of parking. I'm promoting a way of looking at it where you say, how many hours of the year is a parking space used, right? And it should be a reasonable percentage. Do you want to guess what percentage of the total hours in the year a parking space at Angel Stadium is used? Oh, congratulations. It's 4%. So that's not a good use of land. If land is precious, if we're built out, we shouldn't have a parking space that's only used once in a while. Now, in an urban area, it might be 65 or 75% because people are using it all throughout the day, different user groups. So what does parking management do? It uses the existing parking you have better. It can help us manage reductions of parking if that's in the cards, if we think we already have as much as we need and we can convert parking to a parklet or a bicycle lane, or we could build some housing on a surface parking lot. And it can make parking easier and more convenient. So what I mean by the externalities is, I don't know about you guys, but I take a certain pride in finding a parking space, right? So I kind of feel like I'm a lion on the Serengeti and I'm tracking down an antelope, and you know, I don't really do that anymore, so finding a parking space is as close as I get. And so the driver searching for that perfect parking space is one of the most distracted drivers that there can be, right? You are not paying attention to pedestrians or cyclists. You're making weird U-turns because you just saw space open up on the other side of the street. So parking management can make parking space availability more predictable. So, and I'll tell you how that works in a minute. So we call that cruising. When people drive around extra miles looking for a parking space, that doesn't do anybody any good. So an empty space is a useless space. That's my point. This slide never gets a laugh. I only get the laugh later. So you're pretty consistent with previous audiences. So I thought this was funny because it's easy for me to say manage parking better, but when we change what happens with parking, we are entering into dangerous waters, are we not? I mean, very controversial. People are very passionate about parking. There's video programs about parking meters, enforcement officers, and so on. So parking is a very emotional issue. So it's easy for me to come to South Pasadena and say to your consultant, yeah, figure this all out. But I know how hard it is to make change. So I want to talk about how that can be. The one thing I've learned, and after reflecting a lot on this, is I think it's not just parking, it's community image. It's what kind of place are we? So in a small town, you park in front of the hardware store, you go in and buy your plumbing supply, parking is free. The city makes private developers build parking for their uses. Nobody shares parking because it's separate for each use. The bank's parking is the bank's. The restaurant's parking is the restaurant. And neighborhood parking is exclusive to neighbors. And that's pretty much how parking works in a small community. Now, I have a colleague who lives in downtown Los Angeles. Her and her partner have one car, and it's not parked under the building because there's no parking in the building. It's parked a block away. It's expensive. I think they pay $200 a month to park the car. Off-street parking is shared between different uses. Where she was parking her car is retail parking during the day, so she actually has to get her car out for that use to free. Oh, Ellen's shaking her head. That sounds like a nightmare, right? But the thing is, there's parking spaces where you can be there all the time. They're just more expensive. So in a city, you decide whether to have a car, you decide how much convenience you want, and you make trade-offs about convenience versus cost. And I think my point here is that every community in Southern California, and I've worked with lots of them, has to decide, where are we on this continuum? And I've got two, but I'm between small town parking and big city parking, right? And I think as part of your community visioning and so on, you'll need to discuss that issue and figure out where you fit. And so one of the handouts is a chart that says how to go from basic to intermediate to advanced parking management. And that's kind of the purpose of that. I'll get back to that in a minute. So here's the good news. There's all sorts of parking management techniques. And I talk to app developers every day, frequently, who are developing new apps to make parking work better. So there's no shortage of ideas. Lots of private sector interest in getting involved in parking. Consumers want choice and information, right? We're used to getting on our smartphone choice and information, and that is available now with parking in downtown LA. You can find out whether parking spaces are available and how much they cost. And we also have the tighter parking supplies and built-up communities. So lots of cool stuff like little green lights over the space that tell you where a space is available, and interesting kinds of ways of paying for parking and using credit card payment in the meters and pay by cell. Your cell phone pays in the meters, and meters that call you and tell you when your time's about to run up so you don't get a ticket, and great stuff, mechanical parking, an integrated parking management system. So there's no shortage of ideas. Here's the problem. The applications are ad hoc. So private parking, controlled by banks, stores, and other things, isn't necessarily coordinated with the public parking, both on and off street. On and off street parking are sometimes not very well coordinated. In other words, it's to the visitor in your retail districts, it's all one place. And so they experience, if they can experience parking as a system with consistent signage and the same kind of policies, they can say, well, this feels like this place has a lot of parking, as opposed to every use has their own little rules and a chain across at night. I'm old enough that I saw the infomercial for the chicken rotisserie cooker. Is anyone familiar with that? Late night television from the 1980s. The guy would put the chicken in the thing and close it, and then the audience, like you guys, would all say together, set it and forget it. Remember that? There it is. This is a miracle. I don't know. I got this off the internet and the meat changes. I don't know why. I don't know how that happens. Anyway, that's the problem with parking management in many communities. We've had a 2-hour limit on all our streets for 25 years. We don't really know why it's 2 hours. We don't really want to change it because someone will get mad, so we just leave it alone, right? And I have one more picture of set it and forget it. That's the extreme example. That's a parking sign that was there so long that a tree grew around it. Yeah, so that's a problem. So I think communities, chambers of commerce, and the city should be actively thinking about parking, gathering data on how well it's used, thinking about the time limits and whether to price it and all those things on an ongoing basis. I have one more example. And this is not what I mean when I say better parking management. Are you ready? There you go. What's the one thing you know for sure when you see that sign? You're going to get a ticket for something. Right? This is a local example from the city of Culver City, California. I heard about it. Somebody blogged about it on a Friday, and I was writing my second book on parking management. I said, I've got to get out there and get a picture of that. But the city manager got wind of the scorn that was being heaped on Culver City, so he had the public works crew go out, and they took the top half of the signs down by Saturday, but the pole was still there, so it was almost even worse. But that is an example of a very complicated set of rules that no one can understand. It's in front of a school, there's special drop-off, you can imagine how it gets complicated when different stakeholder groups say, well, we need a special accommodation for this and that. So I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about simple, easy to understand systems. Let me just give you an example. You have 2-hour parking limit. I don't know how well that fits with the length of stay of retail customers, but generally there's a way to study that. You go out and you count, you measure the duration of parking. Now, it may be fine. It may be the average length of stay is 90 minutes, and of course, the good thing about the 2-hour limit is it prevents employees from parking on the street all day long, which you don't want. You want your customers on the street. But if the average length of stay, many communities, sometimes the average length of stay is 2 hours and 15 minutes. So it just creates anxiety, right? The merchants aren't happy, people are getting tickets, merchants are running out and putting money in the meter for people and so on. So having data about the length of parking stay would allow you to adjust that if it's appropriate. And again, I don't know what's right for your community, but regularly looking at what the time limits are and making adjustments to them is a good idea. So what does parking management do? It increases how useful each parking space is, makes it easier to find a space. It gives people choices in price versus convenience. And it can help repurpose parking to better uses. The one thing that's not on my list is making parking cheaper. Okay, so you can make parking more convenient with these pricing mechanisms such as are being used in Los Angeles and other cities, but it's hard to make it cheaper, especially if it's free to start with. So this is hard to see, I think, but the idea of these circles is parking management can reduce the total amount of parking needed by encouraging people to travel by other modes, walk instead of drive. And then further, it can reduce the amount of parking needed by better using the parking that exists, so you don't have spaces that are empty most of the time. So what I find is, when I work with a community, they tell me the parking is full, and then the consultant team goes out and does parking counts, and usually we find the parking is about 60% full overall. So it's not full, but it feels full because the bank puts a chain across their parking at night so the restaurant patrons can't park there. So it feels full, but it really isn't technically full. But of course, people go by how it feels, not the data. So there's a lot of things you can do, and this is kind of detailed for the size of this screen, but you can buy advanced parking equipment, parking meters, parking information systems, changeable message signs that when you come into a district tell you there's 55 spaces available in the city lot next to City Hall, or tell you that it's full and redirect you to another place. So there's stuff you can buy that will make it easier to find parking and better use the parking you have. Then there's the controversial stuff, which is pricing. So the theory of parking pricing is not that anyone wants to pay for parking, but that you can use variations in pricing to produce occupancy and availability. So in Los Angeles and San Francisco, we both got federal demonstration grants to demonstrate dynamic pricing. The idea here is you vary the price up and down a little bit so that your most popular block faces, I don't know which ones, probably down by the rail station, right? Have some space availability, one space open per block. If the spaces are all full, you raise the price a little bit, and if they're empty, you lower it. So in San Francisco, they did this. They didn't end up raising the average price. They raised the price in the most popular spaces, and they lowered the price in the spaces that weren't as well used. The idea then is that a customer comes and sees, wow, I usually drive along Mission, and all the spaces are full, and I don't even try and stop to get a cup of coffee, right? Now they would see a space open, realize they have to pay for it, and say, I'm going to stop and get a cup of coffee. And people who are coming to stay longer might say, I'm going to park in a structure or a city lot or some other shared facility. So the idea is it makes parking in the best places more expensive, but it makes your district give the impression that it's got a lot of parking, that it's not a hard place to park. Now, I have promoted parking pricing in many cities and been told no, because it will hurt business and people won't shop in the district anymore. And I really think that's not correct. I would ask you to think about the other downtowns that you admire. How many of them charge for parking? Most of them do. I know Pasadena is a bigger city, but it has a natural comparison. You've been to Old Pasadena. They have parking pricing. It doesn't vary up and down, but they charge for on-street and off-street parking. They're doing almost everything right. They have shared parking with the office buildings when it's not used at night. Developers pay an in-lieu fee. Instead of building parking, they pay a fee and get to use public parking. So they did a study and found they have a little more than 2 parking spaces for every 1,000 square feet of retail space. And it's working. Retail sales are good. Have you been to the Playhouse District? Go east on Colorado. That's where the Lemley Theater is. It's a nice district too. They don't have any parking pricing, and they don't have shared parking. And everybody in the Playhouse District complains about parking. And they have 8 spaces for every 1,000 square feet of retail. So they have 4 times as much parking, but they're not managing it. Their retail sales per square foot are lower than Old Pasadena. So, and it's the same city, same market area, so it's a pretty good comparison. So if you manage parking, you can have more retail success with less parking. So that's the pricing scheme. Now, there's also rules like parking time limits and so on. So that's, you've got 2-hour limits here and so on. And also residential permit parking is part of the rules, deciding whether others get to park in a neighborhood or not. And finally, you have signage, education, promotional programs to help people figure out how to park or realize that parking is available. So there's a whole set of strategies that can go into a parking management plan. So just a quick summary of some of the common elements. On-street parking in commercial districts, parking management usually starts with time limits, which you have, and space designations for drop-off and other purposes. But many communities are moving to pricing. Did a parking management plan for Uptown Whittier. And this was some years ago. They just did a new specific plan for Uptown Whittier, much as you are doing now. And so we proposed parking pricing in Uptown Whittier, the problem was bars and restaurants were doing very well, and at nighttime there was a problem finding parking, even though there was lots of parking overall. We went to City Council, and an older gentleman got up and he had a big sign, and Uptown Whittier had parking meters in the 40s and 50s, and they took them out. And that was the period where downtowns felt they were competing with suburban shopping malls, so if a shopping mall has free parking, we must also have free parking. And he had this big picture, and he said, it didn't work then, and it won't work now. And one of the councilmen said, I would have agreed with you 5 or 10 years ago, but we have a new vision for Uptown Whittier. We have adopted this new specific plan, and we can't achieve the specific plan's goals doing parking the old way. So the powerful lesson for me is, talking about changing parking by itself is not popular. Everybody says, why change it? Leave it alone. But you are doing a new community plan and specific plan, which is the perfect time to say, how does this change in parking fit in with the vision that you will develop for your specific plan? A parking benefit district is what Old Pasadena pioneered, which is, they said, we're going to put in meters, and we're going to use the money for improvements, improving alleys, power washing streets, better security. So for the merchants, it wasn't just something bad happening to their customers. There was a direct benefit that the money flowed back for improving Old Pasadena. So if you ever go, I think I have a picture. You ever go there and look at the parking meter, there's a little sign that said the money in this meter goes to improve Old Pasadena. So that's a good way to have something in it for local merchants. In residential neighborhoods, it's traditional to think that that on-street parking in front of your house is yours. You know, technically it's the city's, it's public right-of-way, but I understand the feeling because it's your neighborhood. So Boulder, Colorado, for example, had residential neighborhood next to an employment center, and people from the employment center were parking in the neighborhood, and the residents weren't happy. And so the normal thing would do be to have a residential permit district, which would forbid non-residents without a permit from parking in the neighborhood. That's commonly done in many places in LA. What the city said to the neighborhood is, what if we issued a limited number of neighborhood parking passes for the employees, and you get the money? And the money goes to street tree trimming, sidewalk repair, rec programs in the summer. So again, the same idea of a parking benefit district, only in a residential area. So that's, if you have residential permit districts and issues with that, that's a way of finding a win-win where you find some more parking, but the neighborhood actually benefits from it. Off-street parking, you have a lot of off-street private lots along Mission and Fair Oaks. And so there, you know, I walked by tonight that office building, I don't know the name of it, near the freeway in Fair Oaks, the brick three-story building. It's a ton of parking and it's completely empty because people aren't there. So if you had a proposal for commercial uses or some nighttime entertainment uses, and on the site next to it, it's a logical prospect for parking, for shared parking. Now, individual property owners' first reaction is, why would I want to do that? It's a hassle. I don't want other people on my site, and so on. So the way to handle it is, there needs to be money in it. This is another reason why pricing is good. If there's money in it for them, then they're incentivized to do that. City of San Clemente did a brilliant thing. They had a parking issue. The residents said to the city, you need to build a parking structure, another parking structure downtown. And the thing about building a parking structure on any one of your public lots is that you're building on an existing parking lot, and so the cost per new space is quite high. So it's very expensive. So the city manager didn't really want to do that, didn't feel they had the money. And he noticed there was a lot of uses around the downtown, private uses, whose parking was empty at the key times. And so what they did is they entered into short-term leases with private property owners and said, may we lease 15 spaces from you from this time to this time. We will mark it as public parking during those times, and we will enforce and tow and stuff if somebody overstays their welcome. And they instantly generated a couple hundred of additional spaces without building a single parking space. So getting the private property owners to engage in this shared parking is something that the city can help facilitate. Your Chamber of Commerce can help do it. It takes some talking and working with stakeholders and working out the bugs, but it's worth it because you can avoid, Laguna Beach was going to build a new parking structure on a surface parking lot, and I think it was $80,000 a space was the cost per net space added. That's a huge capital cost, and they were going to do it for their summer festival season, so they only needed these spaces a couple months a year. So if then you start looking at the economics of it, it was crazy. Okay. Off-street public parking, if you introduce pricing, the general rule is on-street parking should be more expensive than off-street, because on-street is the most convenient, and that's where people want to park the most. Sometimes cities get it backwards. They issued a bond to build their parking structure, so they say, well, we've got to get this much per space. But you want to encourage the long-term parkers to park off-street and encourage the short-term parkers to park on-street, and they'll turn over, and every on-street space will serve many people per day. So generally, this process starts with data. So you do a parking occupancy count, and you create a map like this. You know, red means it's all full and green means it's empty. And seeing that visually really helps stakeholders realize where there's opportunities to use the parking better. You really want to get the right parker to the right space. If you didn't have a two-hour time limit, employees would park on Mission all day, blocking out customers. Then there's the coordination within the city between different city departments. I don't know how South Pass is organized, but you might have the finance department in charge of collecting fees, community development, planning, police department with enforcement, facility management. So the city needs to get organized internally. Then you have private parking owners, building owners, parking operators, and so on. And then you have nonprofits. And the more you can bring those three groups together and coordinate and have regular meetings and talk about what's going on, the better. Shared parking is the single most important thing you can do. Here's a gated off lot, empty during the day, right? And so you have to work at finding shared parking arrangements that work for the stakeholders. My claim is that winning places charge for parking. I had a job helping a church who wanted to sell a parking lot off to generate revenue for church operations. And their parishioners said, well, we come for the free parking. And I'm like, is that why? That's not right. So people come for the activities, not the parking. And so that's old Pasadena. That's a city parking structure. Behind it is the container store, which has no parking of its own, which pays a fee every year to support the city's development and operation of public parking. Which, you know, usually strikes horror into stakeholders' minds. Yeah. I work with a guy named Rick Williams a lot. He's a consultant in Portland, Oregon, and this is a little detailed for our presentation, but if you're going to set up a parking district, these are the ideas he says should be embedded in the organization. Clear management principles, good organizational structure, clarify the role of on and off street parking, and if you're going to have pricing, establish a protocol for how it's adjusted so you don't go to council every time you want to change the parking price. Measure performance, communicate it, look at new technologies as they come along, and keep financial transparency. What you want to avoid is your stakeholders to think that parking is just a money gouge by the city, either parking fines or parking meters. So you want transparency, you want to, and you, I think it's ideal to say use the parking money to improve transportation or district conditions, rather than just flow into the general fund. Also, it costs $150,000 or more, $100,000, to do a comprehensive parking study. It takes some time if you have stakeholder process and everything else. I really want to emphasize that you do not have to do a big parking study to get started. The cool thing about parking management is it's reversible. If you get it wrong, you can change it. You can change the price in the meter. You can restripe the spaces. So you really can begin in the places where it makes most sense to begin. There's the old Pasadena sign on their parking meters. That's good PR for the pricing. I mentioned SF Park and LA Express Park. Lloyd District in Portland's done great things. Redwood City in the Bay Area is an example of a smaller city that's using a simpler, they have just a simpler set of prices, but they do vary price by location. Tacoma, Washington's building an integrated management system. Old Pasadena, as I mentioned, and I mentioned Boulder already. So I think the most important thing is to understand the difference between a lack of parking and a lack of information and management, right? Often we think there's not enough parking. There actually is, and management tools can help make that work. I'm not going to go over, but that's your handout, which allows you to see kind of where's South Pass today, and if you wanted to make the next step in parking management, what one step would be. I mentioned connecting your parking reform to community plan efforts, and that's what you're doing tonight. Certainly we want to educate stakeholders, but what I found is many people don't want to be educated because they might lose their favorite parking space, so it's like, no, thank you. So I'm much more, as I've grown older, appealing to self-interest, right? Does the city manager know how much revenue is being lost by a lack of economic development? Do business districts realize how much revenue return they could get for business district improvement from parking pricing? And then finally, there's a lot of allies for parking reform if you want to connect with them, whether that be infill developers, small businesses, historic preservationists, and so on, can all benefit from better parking management. So in sum, shared mobility will reduce parking demand in the future. It's a key policy issue going forward, and I'm glad you're spending time on it. The first step is to reform minimum parking requirements. I'll tell one last story. I'm almost done. Working for developers in the city of Riverside. Riverside, if you've been to downtown Riverside, they've done a beautiful job of public improvements, and they've got everything happening except housing. So there's people there during the day, and there's not people there at night. Riverside has the same parking requirements in their downtown as citywide. So developers come to build perfectly appropriate infill housing and are faced with the same kind of parking requirement you'd have if you're in suburban Riverside. You know, so they're in the process of looking at that, but that's an example of a first step. Reform your, and you already have different parking requirements for the Mission District specific plan, so you're already there, but it's important to make that distinction. And I've written two books about this, which I would welcome you to look at. I have some flyers on them, and they have a discount on them. But I'd be happy to answer your questions.
Do you have, I've got two questions. One is, do you have, in your experience, what we have right now? We have tremendous parking spaces at the Vaughan Center, and we hope someday the Rialto Theater comes back, and I'm not sure what kind of land use. It is a theater, may change in its use, but right now there are big signs at the Vaughan's parking lot, no theater parking. And so you've got a private entity in both properties, and I hear that the city can get involved, but is there an example of something similar elsewhere where they were able, all these shareholders got together so that there could be a sharing? Because it seems like the entities in Vaughn's, and there's other smaller stores there, would be concerned that, well, if you have matinees or whatnot, it's going to infringe on their ability to retain customers. Well, not in the evening, no, but I mean, theaters typically, if that's what it's going to be, theaters typically have matinee and early afternoon shows. So I was wondering if you had any examples of real-world examples on that.
Well, so that's a great question and a great opportunity. In any shopping mall has already figured this out, right? So if you look at the Westfield Shopping Center at the corner of the 405 and the 134, I can't remember what that thing's called, it features office uses and mostly theater and restaurant. So it's a perfect complementary shared parking use. Now, it was developed that way. In any downtown, that is already happening. I think the problem is, for the owner of the Vaughn's, there's no incentive to do it right now. So if South Pass introduces parking charges, see, the owner of the mall wants to charge for it. But if parking's free on the street and everywhere else, no one will use it. So it's hard to get that started. So first of all, smart developers and property owners are figuring this out and negotiating these agreements on their own. I think if they don't, then the city can try and encourage that, but can't really force it to happen. But at some point, the lost value of not taking better advantage of that parking will become apparent to the property owner. But I would say, I would look for shared parking opportunity. If they're holding out and won't do it, I'd look for other places to do it. And certainly the agreement you come to says exactly when you get to use the spaces, what would happen if someone stays, who's enforcing it. You got to work out all those details to make people comfortable.
Thank you. And the other one that, of course, with the general plan update that needs to be addressed, and it has been in a recent separate, session with the city council, has been the issue of affordability and the fact that we don't have affordable housing units here in South Pass. And there's been, of course, concerns by those tenants, say like on Raymond Hill or whatnot, concerned about their rents going up. So the city council now is grappling with rent control ordinances and all that, whether they should do it or not. What we should be doing is looking, as you say, for alternatives, such as maybe looking at existing facilities, homes and whatnot, and perhaps there are some homeowners that want to convert but have been prevented by land use zoning to do granny flats or subdivide internally, or they're going to have multiple multi-residential units, and then they get slapped also with the parking requirements. The idea of having, like, on some unused portions of the parking lot, residential units of, say, container boxes or something for senior citizens or homeless vets or whatever is great, but then it comes back to parking. In your books or in your presentations, have you thought about the affordability issue where they are trying to densify in certain key areas, but then parking is an issue?
Parking is an issue if the zoning code requires it. So to me, one of the key issues of producing more affordable housing is loosening up on parking requirements. Now, again, residents and community members, affordable housing is controversial, and so often planners want to say, I don't want to take on parking too, because I'm trying to get this affordable housing built. Parking management in the neighborhood, those kind of tools that return benefits to the neighborhood, is part of what I do. But I mean, you have a Gold Line rail station. So you have, the way I would look at parking and residential units is, The fear, of course, is if you approve a development without very much parking, people will park all over the place, right? That's only a fear if parking management is not used. There are tools to control that. So I look at it as households that want to not have a car have to pay the extra cost of building that parking that they won't use. So approving some housing without parking simply gives people the option to live a car-free lifestyle and save some money. Now, if they bring seven cars and try and park them in the neighborhood, well, they'll get tickets. So I think looking at parking requirements for affordable housing is a key issue. I worked on a study in San Diego for the city of San Diego that looked at all different forms of affordable housing, and we measured parking occupancy. It's on the city's website if you as a resource for how, I mean, parking use is much different in senior housing and other forms of housing, so we need to make sure we accommodate that.
Just to add to what Rick's saying, a number of cities in California here have unbundled. To add to what Rick's saying, a number of cities in California, Ventura is one of them, were working in La Habra on a private development project where we're promoting affordable housing by unbundling the parking, the sale and the rent of parking. So if you don't need parking, you don't rent that space. You don't rent that. It's not part of your rent. If you don't need the parking, if you're selling a unit, you just buy one parking as opposed to two. So unbundling it together with tailoring the requirements might also reduce the cost of housing, because as Rick mentioned, a parking space where the land values are incredibly high, such as in South Pasadena, could cost anywhere from $40,000 to $60,000 per space. And that's a huge saving that can be passed on to provide more affordable housing.
Did you do a survey of the demographics? Because here, of course, we attract families with a lot of, you know, kids, but there's going to be a certain percentage of senior citizens, right, or others that won't need the car.
Yeah, absolutely. We did a market analysis, and what we are seeing is the demographics changing, and particularly the type of clientele that the developers are trying to attract. Our family size about 3 decades was about 4 per household. Today it's close to 2. In some areas in LA County, it's even lower than 2. So we may not need quite as many parking spaces as we did in the past.
Thank you so much for these ideas. They're really interesting. First of all, I want to give a shout out for the employees. They do need to park. I mean, there wouldn't be any business without the employees. So I wonder if in these plans that there is a thought, at least, for the employees, even though you don't want them to park in the prime spots for the shoppers, but they should be a place for employees because they're necessary for the city and for the businesses. That's number one. And number two, I really, really, really like the idea of the shared parking, you know, nighttime, daytime. I know that there's an issue of insurance with some of the owners, and they don't want anything to happen, then they're going to get into a lawsuit, and then they don't want all that complication. They rather just chain it off. But walking around the city as I do in the day and the nighttime, there's so much downtown parking that is available that that could be shared. So I really want to say that that's a great idea for this town. One thing that I didn't like is this idea of dynamic parking and raising the rates close to the, I don't know, in our town in on the Mission Street, it's a lot of small shops that I think that would discourage people from going into these smaller shops. They're not, you know, high-end shops, and I don't think that's what we really want. They're unique shops, the way Pasadena used to be, actually. Unique shops that offer unique items. And I don't know, there needs to be something done about parking, perhaps, but the idea of dynamic parking just seems to be a little predacious for me. But I want to thank you for all your ideas. They're very interesting.
Yeah, thank you. And I want to be clear about the dynamic pricing, varying the price up and down. The first step is basic pricing. a dollar an hour or something like that. And then once you see how that works and the benefits of it, you know, it's only larger cities right now that are actually doing that. So I agree with you, that would be, jumping to that would probably be a lot for what people are used to. But having some revenue stream from parking, here's a middle ground that might sound appealing. One thing to do is you have a low price, in old Pasadena, parking's free till 11 a.m., for example. So you might not have it applying all the time. And the first hour could be a low rate, a dollar. And you could get rid of your time limit. And some places are adopting what's called graduated rates. So the rate goes up for the second hour or the third hour. So essentially, you could spend as long as you want, but you're encouraging people to have a shorter stay, and that would avoid, you know, the person getting a ticket because they overstayed 2 hours or something like that. But I agree. I think the council, the community, the merchants all have to get on board with the idea of trying pricing in the most desirable spots, and I would start with a simple system and not outrageous prices to get it going. With regard to the employees, I mean, my first goal from that chart would be to try and encourage people to use transit and other modes of getting to work, but then those that have to drive, it's not that they don't get to park, but they would park off street and maybe a block away from the store or something in the less used parking spaces. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, that's a good point.
Thank you. The idea of the shared parking does sound wonderful, but I have, as I was listening to this, one of the things that popped in my head, and using your example of the shopping mall next to the business, that they could share that parking lot, that sounds good, except for the time that Thanksgiving and Christmas comes around. What do you tell the employees who work at that business that they can't park in that parking lot because it's full of the shopping mall's people? And that's my question.
No, that's a great question. And you know, shopping malls deal with this because they are over 100% parked for some of those days, the peak shopping days. And so what the shopping mall does is shuttle their employees off-site, right?
But I'm not in business of sharing that parking lot.
That's the thing. In the sharing agreement, the business would say, sorry, we're not sharing on these days. So you can specify exactly the days and times when sharing won't occur. And then if it's really varying by conditions, then you can have real-time messaging signs that say public space is available here now or no public parking right now. So you can use technology to keep people right up to speed with what the rule is in the moment. But definitely, the business that's sharing has to make sure that their operations are not affected. I think
question back.
Mine is really a very simple question. Are we going to have access to your PowerPoint?
Sure.
Cool. That was it.
Excuse me. I'm wondering, this lady made a very great point when we talk about affordable housing, and I know a couple people from the Planning Commission are here. Have we looked at what happens with back houses and can people rent them out? Because we have so many in South Pasadena, and that would make so much, would free up so much affordable housing. And it would seem in parking malls that Macy's would have all their people Uber in and pay for it.
Kaiser, you're probably more up to speed. There's a state law that requires that cities allow granny flats, right? You want to talk about that?
Pasadena, South Pasadena now is complying with the state law to allow granny flats, but unfortunately with the urgent ordinance that we passed at the end of last year before it took effect on January 1st, the city, just to throw it out there and be cautious, limited granny flats to properties that are 12,500 square feet or more. So it really limited just to giant properties. I'm hoping with a groundswell here in this room and in the community, maybe we can lower that. You pressure your wonderful, fine, volunteer city council people to lower it to maybe 8,000 square feet. And then it really would happen, and it would work. I think it's a great thing. All the cities are going to have to do it. Where are our kids going to live? They can't afford a house.
Thank you very much. This has been very enlightening. I had a quick question, because we talk about the Gold Line and mobility and alternative forms. One of the issues that has come up with the expansion, and certainly we've had some of it here, is the people that want to take it, where do they put their cars? So they end up parking off street, fill up lots and such, so then you don't have, and those people are there all day. And even on weekends, a lot of people will take it. And so you end up with a lot of the parking, so it's figuring out how do you deal with the parking and that transportation of getting from your home or whatever to get to those Gold Line onboard and offboard locations. If there's been thoughts about what you've seen in other cities where people might have looked at alternatives or different ways to deal with that.
I mean, there's a lot of communities that are dealing. Azusa, when they opened the extension, found lots of parking demand in their downtown as an end-of-the-line station. So the message of City of South Pasadena managing its parking for its purposes, I think, comes first. Accommodating park-and-ride commuters is a nice idea if there's room for them. But in terms of my suggestion with parking management is prioritize the user groups, right? I think retail customers are high up there, employees are somewhere in the middle, and someone driving a mile to the Gold Line station and wanting to park all day is not really serving your businesses and your community. Now,
unless you live up in the hills.
Yep. And so the problem we call this is the last mile connection. So we're building this transit system, but we're building it in a system that was designed for cars. So my slides about the future, I mean, some transit agencies are using Uber and Lyft as part of the last mile connection. And as we go forward in time with self-driving vehicles and so on, I think some of that will be addressed. But it's a big problem. And then the economist in me says that park and ride people should be able to park as long as they're willing to pay. Right, but the idea of providing free parking all day for them, I don't think that's what the ultimate goal of Metro has. They want to get people to stations by other modes.
Thank you for your presentation. It was really great. I moved here from the Midwest, so I love big, wide parking lots where land is cheap. But so I think when we talk about parking, it's here, California has different, I mean, it's a different world. But when I moved to Pasadena, it was in the middle of all of that old Pasadena litigation about historic preservation, et cetera. And it used to be a ghost town, except for a few little places. But one thing that Pasadena, I thought, did really well was it built a couple of city lots, including that one by DeLacy or on DeLacy, that still the first 2 hours are free. So, and there are lots, really, it was a smart move because it was still in litigation, but they built a couple of city lots in that old town area that are still really popular and functional. And I think it was foresight as to what old town was going to become. So I'm just hoping that when we do our plan, both the general and the specific street plan, that we have a little planning on the foresight of what we'd like to see that will include things like the Rialto and more retail, et cetera, et cetera. I think it's very important to not just focus on what we have now, but realistically what we think we might become. And I don't know how we do that, but maybe you have thoughts.
Well, you know, there's places that have built giant inappropriate parking structures that wreck the streetscape and dominate, you know, and create too many trips in and out in the driveway. What Pasadena did was appropriately sized infill parking structures. Okay, and I'm not opposed to that. I think that's a good idea, especially if it allows you to then build on gas station lots, large surface parking lots that you have. If you can there's an economic value in turning low-intensity uses into housing and other important community uses. And if some of that value can be harnessed to then build a shared parking structure that the developers contribute to through an in-lieu fee or some other mechanism, then you created the key to an efficient land use system. When it's each parcel one at a time providing its own parking, the parcels are small, it's very expensive to do underground parking, the parking lot's not efficient. So it may be somewhere in the future there's a place for a structure that's funded by developer fees who then don't build any parking.
I just wanted to say that one of the things, I live here and I work up in Old Pasadena, and one of the things I've noticed is when you're referring to this before 11 a.m., how it's free and the 2 hours free, in a way that's almost kind of a demand pricing. Because it, you know, if the demand is less in the morning, then I'm able to, if I'm going to go to a meeting at 10 o'clock, I'm able to park on the street for that half hour, an hour and a half before I go to the meeting, and I can take advantage of that really more convenient parking for short term, but then for the long term, I park in a garage that's about two blocks away, and that's fine. But to have that option of the in and out, and also it just makes it more, like I always kind of feel like, as Old Pasadena has gotten more dense and more chain store oriented and all that, and the Playhouse District feels more local, there's a perception, and these numbers that you gave us for those two districts are really fascinating, because it is very hard to park in the Playhouse District. But as it's kind of ramped up to that, I've always felt like the Playhouse District was kind of more for local people because you didn't have to pay for the parking. And I don't know where that perception comes from in my mind, but I just feels like, you know, you own that parking space and you own that street, and so you have, you know, like when I come into Mission Street in a car to park at a business, there's something very satisfying about being able to just park for free and go in. But if you don't have to give the people free parking all the time for them to have that perception is probably what you're saying. So if even just giving them a little bit of free parking when it's convenient to do so still kind of breaks down that resistance to having to pay for the parking some of the time when it's reasonable to ask for it.
That's a great point. My doctor's in the Playhouse District, and I'm the parking guy talking about dynamic pricing, and I enjoy parking for free so much. I mean, that's the thing. I don't like paying for parking, but the principle, the economic principle, is not parking pricing is to gouge people. If the demand is lower than the supply, the price should be zero. And so if you had pricing in the Mission District, you would make strategic choices about when it applies, and you'd make it work for the merchants and the users. So I think, but your point about the feel, it's true. And so this is part of the cultural aspect of the Mission District. What kind of place are we? What kind of place do we want to become? And what is often not evident is, what's the cost of what we're doing now? Like, you know that your customers will say, I'm going to stop shopping at your store if there's parking charges. What you don't know is the number of customers you're missing, because they go down Mission and it's full all the time. So the voices to keep it the same are strong, and the people who would come if there was charges, you don't hear from as much. So,
Rick, I had a question for you. Have you heard of communities do this as a demonstration project, something that can be tried and see if the sky falls, and if it doesn't, and if it's yielding an annual income that can be used to make improvements along the corridor? I just read a couple days ago that the Old Pasadena, they get $1 million in their budget just from the parking meters in the Old Town area. So that's money that they are putting back and investing back along the corridor. So is this something that can be tried as a demonstration project? And second question related to that is, if there is appetite for pricing, what happens to the adjacent neighborhoods do they get spillover because of some person looking for a spot that is free?
Yeah, there's a lot of things you can do on an experimental basis in terms of changing time limits, designating curb spaces. The one thing about pricing, though, is there's some equipment involved. So there is a certain scale you have to do. You have to run the numbers and say, how many meters do we... Like, you wouldn't want to introduce pricing on just one block because the cost of collection and taking care of the meters wouldn't be paid for by the revenue. So there's a way of doing a revenue hour analysis to see how much revenue you get. You compare that to the amortize the cost of the meters and the new, you know, the taking care of them and so on, and then you could figure out if it's worth it. But I would say for pricing, you should go for it in terms of committing to a certain number of blocks for a five-year period or something like that to make the best use of your money. What was the second? Oh, spillover, of course. So if you introduce pricing that affects people's behavior, some of them might say, well, I'm going to park in the neighborhoods around. So like in the city of LA along Melrose, very popular retail district, there's single-family residential neighborhoods right abutting the back of the stores. So that's where residential permit programs can work. You can introduce a program where you issue permits to residents and either at no time or just during the day or just during at night, if you don't have that permit, you can't park there. So there's a way of controlling it, and often the neighborhood wants that assurance when the pricing goes in that they're not going to experience a lot of spillover impact. The other thing, of course, is we'd like people to park in their garages. So I would be in favor of pricing residential permits, but it's currently not allowed under California law, so the city can only charge the administrative cost of running the permit program. Because I think a lot of people are storing cars on the street and using their garages for something else. But until state laws change, that can't be affected.
In South Pasadena, we have to pay to park on the street. I mean, $100 a year, or for seniors, $50 a year. So, and I think that's, I guess, what you're saying. So that would prevent people from having a big garage full of junk and paying on the street. I mean, they wouldn't want to pay $100 just so they could keep worn out stuff in the garage.
Well, you'd be surprised. I mean, that the garage has a lot of value if you're using it as a home office or a ping pong room or something else. So it may be that people are willing to pay that $100, but I wasn't aware of that. So that's a disincentive to that activity.
Hi, Rich. I wanted to also echo thanks for your great ideas and thanks because, you know, I was one of those proponents that said we should just build new structures. You know, we need more structures here. And I think a lot of your ideas are good about shared use of the existing parking that we have here in South Pasadena. But I was also wondering, you've been doing a lot of comparisons to the city of Pasadena. And I'm wondering about, like, the city of Alhambra. You know, I've always kind of admired the way they've done things because they've laid out structures in particular areas, and they're all free. I think they're all free, at least the ones by the movie theaters and the ones, you know, by their restaurant and entertainment areas are free. And I noticed they did a big development over there on Garfield, just south of Main Street. And they did a big outdoor lot. But I believe that it's shared also, you know, by the businesses and also by the new development there. I was just wondering, you know, what your thoughts were on that and how that comparison is to the city of Pasadena. Thank you.
It used to be a strategy of redevelopment agencies that the redevelopment agency would build a parking structure to stimulate development, revitalization, and new development. So I think some of the structures you can see in Southern California were there with redevelopment money, and redevelopment agencies no longer exist. So the real challenge for the city is money. It's just very expensive, and they don't have that tax increment source of revenue to build structures. So if a city has built a large structure and it's free, the question is what other city services are being sacrificed to make the bond repayments on the bonds for the structure. So I think many cities would like to build a structure, but when they face with the cost pressure, they find they don't have the revenue to do it. I don't know if the city wants to comment, but yeah.
Thank you. I wanted to ask you about valet parking. We've just recently had our sort of experimenting and have implemented our first valet parking in front of crossings, and that takes up about three parking spots certain days, you know, Wednesdays through Sundays in the evenings. And so there's still some questions about whether that's the just the economics of that, and how is it fair to other retail shoppers who are trying to go to the neighboring businesses. So just wanted you to comment on valet parking and how you would fit that into the structure that you're talking about with parking management.
Thank you. Valet parking is a good tool if the idea is using the parking you have as efficiently as possible, because the valet can park the car in a structure or a location that the patron might not go. I think the only, so I'm in favor of using valet parking. It can also convince a reluctant property owner to share parking. They'll say, I don't want all sorts of people walking on my property, wandering in and out. And so you say, okay, just the valet will access your site. The issue of curb space, though, is highly, you know, sought after, so you want to make sure you're not allocating more curb space than absolutely necessary. And then if the other businesses feel they're harmed by that, work on ways of, you know, there's a lot of, also in the area of signage and information you can use to help people, encourage them to use that combined metro structure or other parking facilities. So I would say, you know, any change affects different people, so you want to address the businesses that are affected by those spaces as well as you can.
Thanks. First, I had a quick comment. I used to live in an apartment building that had uncoupled parking, and I thought that was great because a lot of the students decided to save the $200-$300 a month it was for a space, and that's something there honestly isn't that option for the most part in this whole region, or at least when we've looked. The second thing, I had a question regarding phone apps. I've heard just kind of like with the home sharing, there are car space sharing apps that you can use for private property, like if you have additional spaces that you're not using, and it's a way for property owners to get some revenue without having to set up an elaborate system. So have those taken off at all? Can you speak at all to the use for those, for example, around maybe transit stations, if someone has a space they don't need that someone could use for parking?
So this is the idea of this is the sharing economy idea, that if you have a parking space in front of your house that you vacate every day, that you could use an app to make people aware that you're willing to rent it to them, and then they would use that space. The most I've heard about that is in areas like San Francisco, where density is really high, parking prices are really high. But in terms of the commuter to the Gold Line station that we talked about earlier, that does seem like a pretty neat idea for using some of the capacity, and that, you know, it's purely voluntary. The owner of the house would decide they wanted to make their driveway space available. So from what I hear, it's not common, but it does exist. And so this is the kind of technology that will help facilitate this sharing in the future.
I want to thank you, Rick, for an exciting and very informative presentation. Rick mentioned a couple of things. I want to just reflect on those because we this is not the last opportunity to discuss parking. We have our consultant, Lauren Madden, who worked on the SF Park program that Rick mentioned. She'll be initiating in the following weeks a parking occupancy study. So we'll have all the data available, and those the information will be analyzed and we present it at the charrette. The charrette will take place from April 24th, Monday, through April 28th. Thank you. Lauren's going to speak on Wednesday afternoon. So if parking is of interest to you, I would strongly encourage you to come to the Wednesday afternoon meeting. And I'm told that there will be some light refreshments and lunch, so we'll feed you as well. In addition to that, we have our last speaker who will be here on April 18th. Dr. Richard Jackson will be here to talk about public health. So I encourage you to participate in and take advantage of that as well. You had a question?
About the charrette, some of us work full time, but these lectures sound extremely interesting, but I can't afford to take off those days. Is there a possibility that they could be taped and made available through like the city's website or something?
The charrettes are in the evenings too, right?
Well, not the lectures.
I can certainly tell you that the presentations will make them available. We'll look into if there is a possibility to tape them. They're not going to be held here where we have the taping equipment. They'll be held in the South Pasadena Unified School District boardroom across from the library. So we'll certainly look into that and see if that's a possibility.
The reason why I ask is it's one thing to look at PowerPoint presentations. It's another thing to hear questions.
You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
And I would like to hear those things, but like I said, some of us work full time.
Yeah. And our entire team will be there in the evening. So if you're, for some reason, we understand, you know, you can't attend all the 5 days. We will be here. And we'll certainly be here in the at the lunchtime. We'll be here in the evening, but we'll be here during the entire course of 5 days. So if you have any time during the week and you want to stop by and say hi, can you talk about this, what you discussed, or share your presentation, we'll be happy to do that. And our team members will be there in the evening, so you can talk to them as well in the evening.
When is the parking study that you said Lauren's going to do?
Lauren's initiated. She's working on it right now.
Because in the past we've had some parking studies done, and it's like done at really odd hours, and then they'll say, oh, there's no parking. But it depends on like when the library is open, when the schools are open, when, yeah. So I'm just curious, yeah. Is it at the peak times and at different days?
Typically it is done at peak hours as well as off-peak hours. And then they try to figure out if there are certain events where you have unusual peaks and you try to gather that information. But if you have any information when you would like that we don't know of, the information to be collected, we'd be happy to share that information to our traffic consultant.
For better or for worse, the school district did do a parking study in connection
with the project.
You've got that.
You said there was no parking.
I know, but
we've got all of the existing studies that are available either through the CEQA document that they prepared for the projects that went through, or some of the other resources that we've received from the city. So we'll be gathering and using all of that as a base, and then refining and doing some original work as well in gathering the data.
What is the name? Her name first name is Lauren, and what is her last
name? Mattern.
Mattern.
M-A-T-T-E-R-N is, I think, how you spell her name. We have a poster with a flyer that has her name and the time of her lecture on that flyer as well. If there are no questions, I'll wish you good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.